Good morning and welcome to Eastminster Presbyterian Church. I'm Kate Strickler, one of the worship elders. We're happy to have you with us today and welcome to those of you who are not only here in the sanctuary, but those of you who are visiting with us virtually. We welcome you to worship. We're happy to have today our executive presbyter, Aaron Cox Holmes, with us today to lead us in worship. She's going to prepare us for Josh Gill, I guess. At any rate, thank you so much for leading us in worship. A few announcements. Georgia Mazzola is not here, is she? All right. One Great Hour sharing, please take note to that. One Great Hour sharing, which is usually done in Lent, was delayed because of the COVID. And so we're running that for a few weeks, and it's an appropriate time in light of the fact that Hurricane Laura, which hit Lake Charles and other areas, really did a lot of devastation, and it'll be quite a while until they can get themselves back. I heard a news report yesterday how desperate they are for water, for anything at all. So what you may give to the One Great Hour sharing will go to the disaster relief section that funds will go to there. Next Sunday, of course, in fact, starting tomorrow, our new pastor, Josh Gill, will be with us, and so we welcome him and his family, and I hope you will be gracious to him. We're all looking forward to that. Today started our Sunday school. They started at 9 o'clock this morning, and so we were happy to get that program back on schedule. Please take a look at the people on our prayer list, an update on Dee Hoyt. She had her surgery on Friday, is still in the hospital and expects to come home tomorrow. Any other announcements? Let us worship our Lord.
Well, good morning to those of you who are gathered here and to those who are worshiping with us from scattered around in your homes. I am so delighted to be with you on this last Sunday before Pastor Josh and family start. I was in touch with him to see if they might like to come today, but they had moving vans come and they were taking a quick family trip up to Buffalo, New York. So he is looking forward to starting with a bang tomorrow. Will you join with me, please, in the call to worship? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name. Who forgives all our iniquity, who heals all our diseases. Who satisfies us with good as long as we live. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And as we prepare for worship, join me in the prayer of approach. Gracious God, once again, you have called us together in this place. God, in this time of song and prayer and speech, and when our time of worship is ended, we pray in the name of the one who brought your healing love, Jesus of Nazareth. Amen. Claim that we are without sin, we are deceiving only ourselves. God is not fooled, nor are those who live with us and know us. But if we confess our sins, then God is faithful and just and waiting to receive us with love and with mercy. Friends, be bold and join me in our prayer of confession. Holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another that we have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have grieved your Holy Spirit. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are. Shape and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. Jesus did not come into this world looking for those who think they're righteous. Jesus came to seek and to save the lost and the broken. When we belong to Christ, we are a new people. The old is over and done with, and the future belongs to God's hope for us. Friends, believe this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
And Randy, it is on now. So in our time for young worshipers, I am inviting those of you who are here in the sanctuary to be children at heart and to join with all of our young worshipers worshiping by live stream. Today we are going to hear a narrative from my very favorite theologians, Frog and Toad. They are the creation of Arnold Lobel, and this story called The Garden is my very favorite. Now you all have a part to play. And in other times, the before times, the pre-COVID times, the times we will get back to again, this is your opportunity to really act it up in your interactive part. In this particular time, all of your responses will be in the same muted tone that we use to keep everybody safe. So your line, whenever I say the words, now seeds, your response is, start growing. So let's practice it. Now seeds. All right. And you will see where the dramatic opportunities come and imagine how you would be dramatic. And those of you at home, ham it up. Frog was in his garden. Toad came walking by. What a fine garden you have, Frog, Toad said. Yes, said Frog, my garden is very nice, but it was hard work. I wish I had a garden, said Toad. Here are some flower seeds. Plant them in the ground, said Frog, and soon you will have a garden. How soon? Asked Toad. Quite soon, said Frog. Toad ran home. He planted his flower seeds. Now seeds start growing. Toad walked up and down a few times. The seeds did not start to grow. Toad put his head down close to the ground and said loudly, now seeds start growing. The seeds still did not start to grow. Toad put his head very close to the ground and shouted, now seeds start growing. Frog came running up the path. What is all this noise? Frog asked. My seeds will not grow, cried Toad. You are shouting too much, said Frog. Your poor seeds are afraid to grow. My seeds are afraid to grow? Of course, said Frog. Leave them alone for a few days. Let the sun shine on them. Let the rain fall on them. Soon your seeds will start to grow. That night, Toad looked out the window. Drat, said Toad. My seeds have not started to grow. They must be afraid of the dark. Toad went out into his garden with some candles. I will read the seeds a story, said Toad. Then they will not be afraid. Toad read a long story to his seeds. Now, how seeds start growing. And all the next day, Toad read poems to his seeds. Once upon a time, now seeds start growing. And all the next day, Toad sang songs to his seeds. Now seeds start growing. And all the next day, Toad played music for his seeds. Now seeds start growing. Toad looked at the ground. The seeds still did not start to grow. What should I do? Cried Toad. These must be the most frightened seeds in the whole world. He whispered, now seeds start growing. Then Toad felt very tired, and he fell asleep. Toad, wake up, said Frog. Look at your garden. Toad looked at his garden. Little green plants were coming up out of the ground. At last, shouted Toad, my seeds have stopped being afraid to grow. And now you will have a nice garden too, said Frog. Yes, said Toad, but you were right, Frog. Growing a garden is very hard work. The end. as we turn to God's word, join me in the prayer for light. Oh God, we come with eyes open to the beauty around us, with ears open to the sounds of summer galloping into fall, with hearts open and glad for one another and to be together. We ask that you open our eyes to your love, to open our ears to hear your voice, and to open our hearts to leap to respond to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, the living word, amen. So our first reading of the day comes to us from the book of Exodus. Listen to catch God's word to us. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a shrub. And he looked, and the shrub was blazing, and yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside to see this great sight and see why the shrub is not burned up. And when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the shrub, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. And God said, come no closer. Remove the sandals of your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on the account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me, and I have seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of all of Egypt. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And our New Testament lesson, I am pulling up part of it because I sent the wrong chapters off to Beth Ann. It is from Revelation 21 and Revelation 22. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling of God is among humankind. God will dwell with them, and they will be God's peoples. And God's self will be with them. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And he also said, write this, for these words are trustworthy. You can trust them. They're true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of nations. Nothing accursed shall be found there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it. And the Lamb's servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads. And there will be no more night. They will need no light of lamp or of sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. And he said, these words are trustworthy. They're true. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So on this most auspicious day, the day before the start of your new installed pastor, I bring you my greetings from my colleague Michael Wilson and the blessings of the Connecting Our Ministry Commission and the leader team and our prayers for you as you begin this new adventure together. When I started in the Presbytery of Donegal over 10 years now, they handed me a position description that had been developed over time. And the first item on this position description said, the executive presbyter shall maintain the corporate calendar for the Presbytery of Donegal. Now, never had I seen an EP job description, the responsibility to keep the presbytery calendar, and you can bet whenever something shows up in a job description that there is some story related to it. I don't know what the story is, but it was there. The second thing was, it shall be the duty of the executive presbyter to attend worship the Sunday after the departure of the pastor and to declare the pulpit vacant. Now, I always thought that was particularly ironic and, in fact, quite humbling for an executive presbyter, because if you show up in the pulpit to declare the pulpit vacant, then what are you, chopped liver? I mean, there you are standing in the pulpit saying, this pulpit is now vacant. And in course of fact, Pastor Greg Seckman left, Pastor Steve Litch began. The pulpit was never vacant. It was filled every Sunday. So we changed that to say it is the privilege of the executive presbyter or the stated clerk to preach the Sunday prior to the arrival of the new installed pastor, and to be that John the Baptist and do that last preparation and paving of the way. So here we are. I am going to betray my age to you and tell you that when I was growing up in Southern California, if you wanted to go to a movie, the place that you went to go to a movie was to the drive-in. How many of you have ever been to a drive-in? So back then, going to drive-ins really was the only way you went to a movie in Southern California. They were open all year round. And my hubby Kent is also from Southern California. So when our kids were growing up, there was a drive-in up in Brookville, 20 miles away from us in Punxsutawney. And we decided that we wanted to take our kids to a drive-in to experience what our childhoods had been like. So we were shocked to discover that in the modern day drive-in, when you show up, it is just a giant vacant lot. See, back in the day, when you went to a drive-in, Dad slotted in the wood grain station wagon next to a post. And on this post was a big scratchy speaker, and the window would roll down partway with the crank window, and the speaker would get clipped onto the window, and that was how you got the audio. And there was always a double feature. I remember my first drive-in experience that we saw the 101 Dalmatians, And then it was the duty of children to crawl into the back of the station wagon and to go to sleep while the parents enjoyed their parent movie. And it was the duty of children not to let the parents know they were peeking to watch the second movie. So we were shocked when we went to this drive-in to take the kids to see the Hulk, and it was just this giant lot. Their posts were gone. Audio comes over the airwaves through the radio, and that's a game changer, because everybody drove their SUVs in and they parked them backwards, and then they set up camp. They set up giant boom boxes and chairs and pillows in the back of pickup trucks and coolers and tailgating. And everything is pointed every which way. The lines and the everything being just like this were gone. This doesn't actually come into the sermon, or maybe it does, but that is a parable for us as a church from life as we knew it back when we were kids growing up with the post and the speaker and everybody lined up and it was all the same, to the quantum world where we live now and what that means for how a church does ministry in a different world. But when I was a senior in high school, I went with my folks to see the It movie of the summer. It was all the talk of the town, Monty Python and the Holy Grail. How many of you here have seen Monty Python and the Holy Grail? If you have not, I have it on the best of the authority that it can be obtained on a DVD or it can come to you over streaming. So we were watching, and as the credits started to unfold in Swedish, I looked at my parents' faces, and their faces kind of froze and were blank. And the moving went on, the galloping horses with the clicking coconuts being the horse hooves, and it gets to the center of the movie, when King Arthur and his sidekick Patsy and the merry band of knights have come into the woods, and there they encounter the giant, mysterious creatures. And King Arthur says to them, "Who are you?" And they say, "We are the knights of Nee, and we demand that you bring to us a sacrifice." And King Arthur says, "Oh, worthy knights of needs, I shall be glad to bring you a sacrifice. What do you require?" And the knights of needs say, "We demand that you bring us a shrubbery." "A shrubbery? Unless you bring us a shrubbery, you shall not pass out of these woods alive. Nee! Nee!" And I looked again at my parents' faces, and it was very evident that there are two kinds of people in this world. The people that believe that Monty Python and the Holy Grail is the epitome of all cinematography, and those who believe that Monty Python is an utter and complete waste of time. And in our car, we had both kinds of people. Years later, I got married to my husband, Kent, and it became immediately evident to me that in this marriage, we also had both kinds of people. You'll be glad to know I stayed married to him. And it was a great day in my lexicon when the geniuses of Broadway took Monty Python and the Holy Grail, and they turned it into the Broadway musical Spamalot. It won the Tony in its year. As far as I'm concerned, to heck with Hamilton, Monty Python, the Holy Grail, Spamalot ought to get the Tony every year. Well, Spamalot came by tour to Pittsburgh, and I asked, and when asking didn't work, I begged, and when begging didn't work, I shamelessly pouted and got quiet until Kent finally said, "Fine, We'll go to Pittsburgh and we'll see Spamalot. And it was glorious. So in Spamalot, the part of the Lady of the Lake, the diva, is expanded. Well, it's expanded in the first act. And in the second act, she comes out to complain that she's been off stage for far too long. And she sings her signature aria. She sings, "I might as well go to the pub. They're out searching for a shrub. It seems to me they've lost the plot. Whatever happened to my part?" It was glorious. Well, back we climbed into the car for that long, dark drive over the winding rural roads to get back to Punxsutawney. And Kent said, "No, we are not going to put that cassette tape into the player and listen to the soundtrack of Spamalot one more time." So in that dark silence, I was thrust back in my own devices. And out of that silence, there spoke that little voice that dwells in the gut of preachers. And that little voice said, "That'll preach." I said, "What will preach?" Dead silence. Nothing. So the week's rolling along. We're to Wednesday. And the voice says, "How's the sermon?" I said, "What sermon?" Elucidate. Silence. Nothing. But then all of a sudden, I was lifted up out of myself. And I am back. It is my first year of college. I am a budding English major at the University of Redlands. And I am taking my very first analysis of literature class. And I write my very first paper for Dr. Rebecca Jelliff. And I turn it in. And when it comes back, I look at it. And there on the top of it is a grade that I have never seen in my overachieving high school years. This grade starts with a C, and it goes downhill from there. And the paper is a sea of red ink. Well, I take the paper and I climb the stairs, the first of many trips, three flights of stairs, up to the lair of Dr. Jelliff, chair of the English department. And I step into our office and I hold out the paper and I look at her accusingly. And she looks out at me over the sea of books and papers on her desk. And she heaves a sigh and she pulls her glasses down on her nose and looks at me over them. And she says, "All of literature, Aaron, begins with the plot. It starts at the beginning, it rises to the fulcrum, it descends to the end. In your paper, Aaron, you missed the plot." And suddenly, I was back with the sermon. And I understood what that little voice had to say. "Wouldn't you agree with me that our plot as the people of God, it begins and ends with a shrub? Think about it. In the Garden of Eden, there is the tree of And when we get to the very end, that marvelous passage from Revelation, there's the same tree of life. It has now been transplanted into the heavenly city. And in that city, there is the throne of God and of the Lamb. And from the throne, there flows the river of life. And the tree of life grows on both sides of the river, right in the middle of the city. And even the leaves are for the healing of nations. You know, that phrase just goes zipping past us. And I want you to slow that down and dwell in that for a minute. Can you imagine the healing of nations? Think about it. The Sudan, Ethiopia, the Middle East, and Guatemala, and the United States of America, California, and Iowa, all the places with all the devastation. Can you imagine the healing of nations? In the shade of that tree, all creation is mended and reconciled. There's no more death. There's no more disease. No more face masks. No more crying. The Kleenex factory has gone out of business. Think about it. So to get from that beginning to end, the plot of the people of God, well, it takes a major turn, the plot does, with Moses. Did you notice that when Moses looked and saw the shrub that was burning, the text is careful to tell us twice that Moses takes off his shoes because it's holy ground, and he turns aside from his way. And when God sees that Moses has turned aside from his path, then God gives him this new mission to go and lead the people out of captivity. It begins when Moses turns aside to go that a shrub is burning. Now, the plot goes on. It stalls in Habakkuk. When Habakkuk is waiting for the fig tree to blossom, and there are no blossoms on the shrub. But then he reaches the fulcrum with Jesus. He goes into the synagogue, and one Sabbath, he is in the synagogue where he goes every Sabbath day, and he goes forward, and he takes the scroll of Isaiah, and he unrolls it. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because God has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to heal the sight of the blind, to proclaim the release of captives, and to proclaim that this is the year of the Lord's favor." And then he looks at them and says, "This day, the scripture has been fulfilled in your And the plot suddenly, electrifyingly gels in this mission of Jesus. Now, it is only a page over in the gospel that Jesus tells a parable and says, "To what shall I compare the kingdom of God? It is like a shrub that someone planted, and it grew and it grew and it grew until it grew so big that it spread its branches, and all the trees of birds of the air came to nest in its branches. The shrub grows into the tree of life." Our plot is the people of God begins in the garden and it ends in the heavenly city in the tree of life. Well, what does this have to do with all of us? This plot getting us to the new creation, the kingdom of heaven come on earth. Well, the diva had the right question. She just had it with the wrong inflection. "Whatever happened to my part?" she roars. But it's our question. What happens to our part? So it's now my senior year in college. I am happy to tell you, have mastered the art of the analysis of literature and poetry. I have actually, on an occasion, obtained a 4.0 from Dr. Rebecca Jelliffe. And now, in my last semester, I am finally taking Fundamentals of Writing, the Short Narrative. No longer am I going to be analyzing the Hemingways and the Faulkners of the world. No, I am going to be writing my own masterpieces. Now, I know that none of you will probably believe me when I tell you this, but when I graduated from high school, my graduation present was a manual typewriter. And the cool, girly thing about it was a beautiful blue. And when you wrote a paper, you typed it on that typewriter. If you were typing it for Dr. Jelliff, you typed it with a clean carbon ribbon. And you had no more than 3 erasures or whiteouts, or you typed the page over again. And when you rolled that paper up out of the platen and you stapled it together and you clutched it to your chest to go and turn it in, dodging frat boys and puddles, it was the only copy in existence. You didn't scoop it out of the printer tray. There was no backup. That was it. So I turned my story in and anxiously awaited its return and adulation of my skills. And this time when I got it back, it wasn't red ink covering it. She had taken an indelible, thick black marker, and a third of the story was irretrievably gone forever, marked out. I climbed up the 3 flights of stairs. I stood at the door of the den of Dr. Jelliff. After 4 years and many courses, she called me Erin. I called her Dr. Jelliff. I looked at her. She looked out at me over the same sea of books and papers. She heaved the same sigh. She pulled the same glasses down on her nose. And she said, "All of literature, Erin, begins with the plot. It starts at the beginning. It rises to the fulcrum. It descends to the end. And what is it that drives the plot, Erin? It's not description. It isn't adjectives. It is character. Characters drive the plot. And in your story, Erin, the character had no use in the plot. Out with her." Huh. You know, this story of the people of God that begins with a shrub, it rises to the fulcrum of Jesus. It descends to the end when all is wrapped up in glory. It's the characters that drive that plot. In Monty Python and the Holy Grail, King Arthur and his knights are still on their quest from the shrubbery to make it out of the woods. And they come upon a French castle where they endure a ferocious taunting. "Your father is a hamster and your mother smells of elderberries." They are so overwhelmed, these brave knights, by the taunting that they turn tail and they emit their battle cry, "Run away! Run away!" And they turn tail and they run. Now, what is our role as characters in this plot? Well, Jesus seems to think that we are called disciples. And if Jesus is the master gardener, tending the shrub that is going to become what it once was, the tree of life, then we are called to be gardeners as well. Now, Frog and Toad have it right. Growing a garden is hard work. You know this. How many of you have ever spoken and smiled at somebody that you actually don't like all that much? How many of you have ever said, "I'm sorry," even when the issue at hand was not entirely your own fault. How many of you have ever stared at that? I told the 9 o'clock crowd that out of all of the churches that Michael and I attend, we have terrific churches that do a lot of things, but you are the only church that describes yourself to us as a leader-driven church. You are willing master gardeners, and you're going to have a great time with Josh. You know, Josh was under care and ordained not long after I got here 10 years ago. And back in his younger days, he was the genius behind our Presbytery annual youth fall retreat called the Reality Conference. And they were, he and the other pastor at the church where he was the youth director, Covenant, they were going to send out a video to other youth workers telling them that instead of going on individual retreats in the fall, they should bring their youth to our Presbytery retreat. And so they did their video based on Wayne's World. And Josh has a line where he says, yeah, and monkeys will fly out of my butt. And this video went out to the whole presbytery. I happened to find it in our archives, and I sent Josh a text, and I said, so how much will you pay me not to show this to Eastminster on the day that you candidate? And I think he offered a quite tidy sum. Josh is creative and a lot of fun. You have been well prepared through all of your history and well prepared most recently by Steve Litch. And you are going to have a whale of a good time. So let's think about that drive-in one more time where all the posts are gone and things happen in new ways. You know this. If you are going to continue to spread the good news, it has to happen in new ways, in innovative ways. The posts are gone, and the good news comes in all kinds of forms and manners. So be bold and be brave. And as you face the challenges, some of which no one living has ever faced before, a pandemic like this and ministering in the middle of it, listen to the voice of Jesus. Don't listen to King Arthur. Don't yell, run away, and go out and search for the shrub. Amen.
may be seated and let us bring to God our tithes and our offerings.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cries, if only we could hear. People need the Lord, people need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, the open door. People need the Lord, people need the Lord. When will we realize people need the Lord? His light to a world where wrong seems right. What could be too great a cost for sharing life with one who's lost? Through his love, our hearts can feel all the grief they bear. They must hear the words of life only we could share. People need the Lord, people of broken dreams, he's the open door. People need the Lord, people need the Lord. When will we realize that we must give our life for Jesus, eat the Lord. People need the thank you.
may be seated. Don, thank you. Randy, thank you. Let us turn our hearts and our minds to God in prayer. Oh God, we thank you that this world that you love and which is so fallen and so broken is by your gift and your trust and your call a disciple-driven world. You have given to us to be your hands and your feet and your beating heart in this world. We are humbled by this call to us and ask for boldness and energy and willingness to do our part. On this anticipation of a new chapter in ministry for this great and faithful and amazing congregation, we pray for Josh and his family, for the flurry of moving trucks and settling into new houses and the start of ministry here. We pray for their kids and all kids who are navigating school in a way that they have never had to do it before. We lift to you all teachers and administrators, and in fact, everyone who is working to make decisions that are complicated and with data that is unclear. We lift to you the turmoil of this country in a political season and ask that we might be calm and steady heads and cheerful in our trust and reliance upon your providence and your superintending of human history through all these millennia. We lift to you those that we love, whose names are written on the flesh of our hearts, in all the ways that we yearn for them. We pray especially for those that we have listed in our bulletin, for Ron Higgs and Foster and Dee Hoyt, for Tom and Barbara Kosovic, for the family and friends of Donald Minnick, the family and friends of Laura Mook, for Jack Parker, for our Presbytery Administrative Assistant, Chrissy Wells, and her husband, Nate, who is very young and in treatment for a stage 4 stomach sarcoma. We lift to you all the sick, the broken, the incarcerated, those who live in countries that we would be hard-pressed to find on a map, and the ways that they are battling COVID with so few resources. For every place where there is hunger and war and disease, we give you our thanks for those who are working in the front lines to make this world more like the world that you dream. And we pray for the day when all creation will be mended and we will sit in amazement and glory in the shade of the tree of life. And now we pray as you have taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Randy, again, thanks for your splendid music. I was the president of the InterVarsity Christian Fellowship back in the day, and that is the IV signature hymn. Friends, now go out into this world and be gardeners. Gardening is hard work, but oh, the growing of the seeds is worth it. Enjoy your launch and your life with your new pastor. We can't wait to hear how it goes. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit fill you with bubbling joy and resolve. Amen.